A very warm welcome to Daily Dispatch, a show that gives you all the latest news and updates from the digital ecosystem. I'm Priya Sheth. Thank you very much for logging in. Time now to get you all the top news stories that we've been tracking for you this evening. Well, first up, Ola Electric is looking at taking its electric scooter to international markets in countries like France, Italy and Germany this financial year. The company, which is working on setting up a hypercharger network for its electric vehicle, is slated to launch its electric scooter in India in July this year. Now, in 2020, Ola had announced a 2,400 crore rupee investment for setting up its first electric scooter factory in Tamil Nadu. Well, moving on to the second headline of the day, Bengaluru-based neo-banking startup Avail Finance, which brings the blue-collared workforce under its financial umbrella, has raised 24 crore rupees in debt financing led by Altira Capital. Now, so far, the startup has raised about $21.6 million in equity from Matrix Partners, Falcon Edge and Ola. Mahindra & Mahindra has completed 100% acquisition of Meru Cabs. Now, this decision is part of its strategic intent to grow its presence in the shared mobility space. Now, M&M will enhance its current shareholding in Meru from 43.2% to 100%. Well, moving on to the final headline of the day, Kavin Mittal-backed Hike has exited Winzo, a vernacular social gaming platform, for $12 million. Now, this comes even as Hike has launched its own gaming platform called Rush. Now, Hike had earlier participated in the $5 million Series A funding in Winzo back in 2019 and has received a 4x return within 18 months. Well, moving on to our second segment, I have with me someone who's raised $30 million of late. I have with me Sumit Mehta from Lead School. Thank you very much for joining us today. The EdTech space seems to be a very hot space at this point in time. And a $30 million fundraise that's just come in. What does it mean for you?
Yeah, see, I think we've been always committed to transforming schools in the country. And, you know, even though recently EdTech has garnered a lot of attention, we've always seen that this as a core problem to solve in the country. So I think what this allows us to do is reach more and more students in schools. And we are focused on tier 2, tier 3, tier 4 towns, which is where the point of need exists. So, you know, we'll be able to bring more innovation to our students. We'll be able to reach more students and more schools and carry our work forward.
You know, when you look at 2021, a lot of businesses, specifically in the edtech space, are looking at massive expansion plans, massive diversification. So at Lead School, what is your plan of action out there? Is there a blueprint that you have in mind?
See, I think if you've seen what we've been doing over the last 2-3 years, I think our focus has remained steadfast. The only thing that has changed is, because of the pandemic, we've also had to respond to ensure schools are able to continue online despite the disruptions. So I think our approach is very simple. You know, there are 200,000 affordable private schools in India. And if we can really improve how they deliver learning, and if we can improve how the teachers are teaching in these schools, then we can really bring a shift in the learning outcomes of the country. So I think we remain steadfast, focused on transforming schools, reaching more schools and reaching more students. Albeit what we are seeing is that earlier all the schools were running physically, so our way of helping them was to transform the physical classrooms. Now we are working on even hybrid models where, you know, some students are at home and some are in school, or fully online mode where the whole school is running online. So irrespective of the mode of on which the school is running, we're able to support schools now.
So, you know, this really fits into the whole model of pivot and persist. And that's what a lot of startups have been doing at this time, aligning their business models to really match the market environment out there. And you spoke about this whole hybrid concept that you are working on. So how will it really work? Because, there will be some schools that will begin, maybe towards the end of this year. But overall, how do you expect this hybrid model to really work out?
See, the overarching focus is to ensure that student learning is uninterrupted. And if we anchor our actions towards that goal, then as the external environment changes, we've got to ensure that we are adapting to that external environment. So my sense is that in 2-3 months, physical schools will reopen. And when physical schools reopen, then we go back to ensuring that teachers, they have the wherewithal to be able to teach well. Schools are operating well, and really the learning outcomes that we want to achieve is being achieved. But till we get there, there's going to be a transition period where for some times classes will be running online, and then for some time, some students will be allowed to come to school, some would be studying from home because of social distancing norms. So in each of these situations, you know, our goal is that learning should be uninterrupted. So that's how we are progressing to ensure that irrespective of the external environment, irrespective of disruptions, we can make schools disruption proof or pandemic proof, whatever you might want to call it.
You know, when you look at the kind of, you know, the learning outcomes that students are really looking at going forward, what do you think will be the key pillars of these learning outcomes that you'd like to help imbibe in the several schools that you have on your platform?
See, learning outcomes, the good thing is with the national framework, you know, there are grade-wise learning outcomes that, you know, all schools or all students aspire for. The reality, however, is that most students are behind grade level in our country. And, you know, there are multiple studies, whether it is ASSER or whether it is National Assessment Survey, have shown that a grade 3 or a grade 4 student is typically at a grade 2 level. So the question is, you know, what are the ways and means by which we help students cover this learning outcome gap? And that's where our focus is, you know. And if you think about it, a lot of our parents want good quality English medium education for their students, but they themselves are from vernacular background, right? So therefore, there is very little home support. What we need to do is ensure that we are building those rungs in the ladder which are missing for these students so that they can access grade level content. So a lot of the focus is to ensure that students are able to achieve national level grade learning outcomes. And I think we must be the only organization working with schools with a clear goal that if your starting point is X, and in our case, it's typically when schools come to us, they're at a 52 to 55% grade level mastery. And within a year, can we take them to a 70%+? Because that means that majority of the class is now at grade level. And we have been able to consistently show that this is possible if they implement the right integrated system such as LEAD in their schools. So that's where our focus is.
So at this point in time, how many schools do you have on your platform? And is there a target in terms of how many schools you'd like to have by the end of FY22?
I think we're currently working with 2,000 schools, but if you ask me, we barely scratched the surface because, like I said, you know, in India has 1.5 million schools, but even in the affordable private segment, there are 200,000. So our focus really is to get to about 20,000-25,000 in the next 5 years, which will help us, you know, reach 10-12 million students. And if we think that if we achieve that milestone, we'll begin to make a dent in the learning situation in the country.
In terms of overall revenues, what kind of targets are you working with over the next, say, 2 to 3 years?
See, the relevant number for us is number of students reached and the learning outcomes that we are able to achieve with each student. So last year, we were working with about 300,000 students. This year, we've already reached about 800,000. Last year was, mostly the year was in physical classroom. So our average mastery was 79-80%. And then this year, we've just done our end of year exams, which have been mostly in the online environment because of the lockdown. But we've still been able to achieve 74%. So those are the two metrics that we internally drive and we focus on. Because as an education company, I know there's a lot of talk about revenue and valuation. We've always consistently maintained that, you know, as an education company, if we just keep focusing on Saraswati, you know, Lakshmi will come. So just focus on the right metrics. And it's important to keep everyone focused on the right metrics and not get distracted.
You know, when you talk about the future going forward, and we have a lot of startups who are watching this show, how important is it to be nimble and agile in these times? Because, you know, you just said that you're working on hybrid models, you're working on different models to basically, you know, match with the kind of market environment that you have. So how important is it for a startup, and what do you think you did right to be able to stay relevant and persist in this kind of environment?
You're right. I mean, it is important to be agile and adaptable in any market. You know, it's not unique to EdTech. But I think in EdTech, the other thing which is really important is to ensure that, you know, the DNA of the org is focused on the right outcomes, on the right metrics. You know? And that's where, you know, ultimately, we are not a company which is being set up to maximize valuation. I think we are an organization which has been set up to deliver learning outcomes, because that's the problem, that's the core problem we are trying to solve. And my fundamental belief is that, if you find a problem which is large enough, and you're able to solve it visibly, then all other metrics definitely follow. So in a country like India, if you think about it, 260 million students go to school. If you are able to visibly and in a proven manner solve their learning outcome problem, there is no doubt in my mind that, we are going to be an investable company. We are going to be a company which is going to be a magnet for talent. We are going to be a company which is attractive for people to join. But sometimes, if we just focus on the ends and not really pay attention to the means, which is the right metrics, then it is possible that, we can get astray, and then the incentives gets misaligned. So that would be my message, that if you're in education, then let's first deliver education. Everything else will follow.
All right, on that note, thank you very much for being a part of the Daily Dispatch. It's really been a pleasure speaking with you. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Priya. Pleasure talking to you.
Well, time now to wrap up this edition of the Daily Dispatch. Thank you so much for logging in. I'll catch you tomorrow at 5 p.m. Goodbye and stay safe.